At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this webinar to give my talk on lab tests for bleeding disorders and coagulation abnormalities. So this is a very important part of hematology because we get not only inherited but also acquired bleeding and coagulation abnormalities. So therefore, we have to know what are the tests which have to be done. And then we have to decide how to equip the lab and how to thereby go about interpretation of the tests. Therefore, any coagulation lab that you have will depend upon what are the tests that propose to be done. What, depending on the tests, you decide on what equipments and reagents you would like to keep. So in any coagulation defect, we want to therefore start with a group of tests which will cover the entire coagulation. And these include platelet count, a bleeding time, which is an indicator of platelet count, platelet function, as well as vascular function, a prothrombin time, which is an indicator of extrinsic pathway and common pathway, an activated partial thromboplastin time, which is an indicator of intrinsic pathway and common pathway, and a clot stability or clot solubility test, which is an indicator of factor 13 deficiency. So if we look at all these five group of tests, they will pick up hemostasis defects in any inherited disorder, most inherited disorders. So if we have to look at tests, most important tests that we have are prothrombin time and APGT, as I just mentioned. We will come to thrombin time a little later when we come to acquired tests. But what is common to all this is we need to have blood sample collected in dry sodium citrate, 3.2% dry sodium citrate, which comes in blue cap vials. And the ratio that we like to keep is 1:9. One is that of anticoagulant, 9 parts is that of the blood. So this is the schematic diagram which shows what all is covered in APTT and what is covered in thrombin time. Thrombin time actually covers from fibrinogen conversion to fibrin formation. So therefore, we have to be careful about sample collection because pre-analytical errors can alter the test results and thereby give false interpretations. And therefore, not only is it important that you have trisodium citrate as the anticoagulant, there is a mark given on the tube which is at the ratio of 1:9, and the sample should be up to the mark. So sometimes we have pediatricians who say that we were not able to collect. It doesn't matter, we filled half the tube, please do the test in half the tube. That's not correct because the ratio of citrate to blood is altered and will give you false results. Another important factor you have to keep in mind is correction for hematocrit. Where does it actually arise? So when we are doing citrate anticoagulation, we are anticoagulating the proteins in the plasma part of it. So when hematocrit is high, as you get in cyanotic heart diseases, what you will get is that the citrated plasma, the plasma volume will be low, so the citrate concentration will be high. And therefore, you will get fallacious results, and which are not the actual correct ones. So if that is so, high hematocrit is there, you have a normogram that is given in Dacey and Lewis, and you can make a correction for hematocrit and thereby take appropriate volume of your anticoagulant or citrate. There should be a clean venipuncture. If you have multiple venipunctures, you have tissue fluid which comes in and it leads to erroneous results. Once it is collected, it should be properly mixed, and mixing should be done by inversion technology, not shaking, so that there is no froth formation, which will again lead to activation of blood, leading to fallacious in vitro tests. If the transport has to be done for the sample, it should be frozen rapidly so that the coagulation factors do not get spoiled. So how do we process? We process the sample for either manual endpoint checking or a semi-automated or a fully automated coagulation analyzer. An important point we should keep in mind is we should at least process two samples, if not triplicate. Ideal would be to process in triplicates and take the value of the second and the third test that you have. First one just gives you an approximation. And controls should always be run simultaneously. And sometimes you may need to have normal pooled plasma, which a lab can prepare on its own from 20 healthy subjects, calculate their own ranges of various tests and keep it for records, because then you interpret based on those ranges that you have. And the 20 healthy subjects should be equal number of males and females having no history of any bleeds. So we start with the manual PTA-PTT, and all that we need is we need a good centrifuge. Why we need a centrifuge? So that the blood, saturated blood sample that we have, from that we prepare platelet poor plasma and platelet rich plasma. And eventually we are going to incubate in a water bath at 37 degrees centigrade, and therefore this becomes a mandatory requirement for a lab. So what is a platelet poor plasma? It is a plasma which is plasma count, platelet count is less than 40,000 per cubic millimeter, and a platelet rich plasma ideal count is 3 to 4 lakhs per cubic millimeter. How do we make it? So we have PRP, we centrifuge for at 20 degrees centigrade for 10 to 15 minutes at 150 to 200 G. Remember, this is not RPM, this is G. G. When you have a G value, you can again look at Dacey and Lewis, which has a normogram, from which, depending on the radius that you have of the centrifuge, you will be able to calculate the revolutions per minute or RPMs. And then the PRP should be stored at room temperature, and you can do a count to check it is a good PRP. Platelet poor plasma, on the other hand, you do a very high spin at 2000 G. Again, this is G. Please calculate your own RPMs depending on the centrifuges that you have for 15 minutes. And here we should have appropriate platelet count. Sometimes, especially when we are doing lupus anticoagulant, we use a double spin approach. What is it? It is preparation of platelet deficient plasma as far as possible. And this is required for lupus anticoagulant, so that we don't provide the phospholipid that is there, because that is one of the confirmations of lupus anticoagulant that we will eventually check phospholipid correction is there or not. So this, we do a double centrifugation, and here we expect the platelet count to be less than 5,000 per microliter. So as I said, what are the uses of platelet poor plasma and PRP? PPP is used for all plasma coagulation tests that we have talked about. All we are going to talk about, PT, APTT, fibrinogen, D-dimer, FDP, all these things are PPP. So where do we use PRP? It is for basically platelet aggregation studies and also platelet flow cytometry. So of course, we put all the reagents in 37 degrees centigrade. And then the important thing in a manual PT, if you are doing, is you have to be able to pick up the clot formation and visibly by your eye. So you have to be trained to pick up clot as soon as it starts to form. And therefore, what we do in this is we add thromboplastin from outside. We add calcium from outside. And why we add calcium? Because citrate has taken away all the calcium. And therefore, you need to add calcium from outside. So we put calcium chloride. And then we look at the clot formation, the time to clot formation, and therefore we need a good stopwatch. The moment you see a clot formation, you will press the stopwatch and you see how much seconds is it. So we add patient plasma to the tube and we add the thromboplastin and calcium from outside. Normal prothrombin time is 12 to 15 seconds, but as I said, you must have your normal ranges set in your own lab. And anything within plus minus 3 seconds of control is normal. Activated partial thromboplastin time, it's called activated partial, because typically you would have factored the activation and kaolin, and it starts, the coagulation cascade starts. Here, what we are doing, we are adding from outside extrinsic. So we are adding either kaolin or silica or ellagic acid. In automated methods, we don't use kaolin because it sediments and it therefore does not maintain its concentration properly. So, and then we also add phospholipids, because phospholipids are very important for initiation of this entire coagulation pathway. We intubate these for 10 minutes at 37 degrees centigrade, add calcium chloride, and start looking at clot formation. And the moment the clot formation occurs, we press the stopwatch. And the normal value is between 26 to 40 seconds, depending on your own lab range. And within 6 seconds of controlled plasma is taken to be positive. You can also do in a semi-automated coagulometer, where you have these slots where you can put the cuvettes with the blood sample, with the PPP, and add the reagents from outside. And what is automated in this? The detection of gel. So the machine picks up the moment the gel forms and gives you the duration that it has taken. So the advantage of this is, to an untrained person who's not able to pick up a gel formation quickly, the gel formation time is relatively stable for all samples. And therefore, the only thing you have to add is the reagents from outside. So we were doing this earlier, and before we moved on to an automated coagulometer, where everything is a closed system. You just put in the sample in the tube and everything else is automated. So what are the kind of interpretations you can have on PT and APTT? You can either have an isolated prolonged PT and a normal APTT. And when that is the case, in an inherited bleeding disorder, you will think in terms of a factor 7 deficiency. Or you can have a normal PT and a prolonged APTT. And in the background of an inherited disorder, you will think of intrinsic factor defects. And therefore, you need to then do the factor assays and mixing studies. I'll talk about these a little later. But if both are prolonged, then you think in terms of inherited common factor defects, and acquired, there can be a lot of other things which I've not talked. So the question next is, after a PT-APTT that you do, you need to do an assay if any of these is prolonged. If APTT isolated is prolonged, you will think common thing is factor 8 assay, but you might want to do factor 9 assay, and the procedure remains almost the same. The only thing difference that happens is the factor deficient plasma that you use. So how we do a factor assay? We make dilutions of 1 in 10, 1 in 50, and 1 in 250 using imidazole buffer. So when we make these dilutions, we then add to it factor deficient plasma, and then we look at APTT on all these three tubes, intubate with the APTT reagent for 3 to 4 minutes, and then add calcium chloride. And then we plot the APTT and concentrates on log linear or semi-log paper. This is what a semi-log paper looks like. This is on the Y scale. There is, it is the arithmetic scale, and on the X scale, it is a logarithmic scale that is there. You see the weight is coming. 1% is coming here, and then 2 is coming here, 3, 4. This is a log scale. Why we use this? Because when the variation of values is very large, it comes in a small graph paper and we are able to read it. So you can sometimes, one also has a log-log paper, which we use for ferritins. But here we use semi-log paper. 1 in 10 concentration is assumed to be 100%. And what we plot here is the APTT values, and here is the concentration of the factor 8 that is there. So you get a good straight line of the controls, then this is your standard curve, which is good. And then you can read off the factor level after doing the APTT of the factor. So if you don't have access to factor deficient plasma, you can also use mixing reagents. You can use serum, which contains factor 9, 10, 11, and 12, and adsorbed plasma. This is adsorbed by aluminum hydroxide. and this contains factor 5, 8, 11, and 12. Alternatively, if you have funds, you should go in for direct factor deficient plasmas. So the preparation of adsorbed plasma is given here. It's a relatively easy, very economical thing to do in the lab. What are these mixing studies and how do they help? So if there is an isolated APTT prolonged, we want to do a mixing study with normal plasma, 1:1 mix we have. And if we find, if we look at the APTT of each of these tubes, if we find there is a correction of APTT on the mix, then it means that there is a factor deficiency. We incubate it for about 30 minutes to 2 hours and again look at the APTT of the mix, 1:1 mix. If we find it is corrected, then it suggests that there is a factor deficiency. If we find it is not corrected, it suggests there is a factor 8 inhibitor that is there. So this we can use as a screening test for inhibitor testing. So using mixing studies, we can actually identify the underlying inherited defect that is there. So if we have a patient with inherited defect, PT is normal, APTT is prolonged, it is likely to be a defect in intrinsic factors, which could be 8, 9, 11, or 12. If we do mixing studies with normal serum and adsorbed plasma, we get these various kinds of patterns that may be there, each with a specific interpretation. So if it corrects with normal serum but does not correct with adsorbed plasma, it suggests a factor 9 deficiency. If it doesn't correct with normal serum but corrects with adsorbed plasma, which contains factor 8, it becomes a factor 8 deficiency. We have to keep in mind factor 8 deficiency can be seen in hemophilia A and also in von Willebrand's disease, where there is associated platelet function defect, which can be picked up using either a prolonged bleeding time or a platelet aggregation. There may be a possibility that both the normal serum and adsorbed plasma correct the prolonged APTT, and then we will suspect either a factor 11 or a 12 deficiency. Generally, factor 11 deficiency has mild symptomatic disease, and those with factor 12 deficiency have more probably associated with thrombosis. On the other hand, if we have prolongation of PT and APTT, and it is an inherited defect, we will think of one pathway defect, which includes factor 5 deficiency, factor 10 deficiency, prothrombin or fibrin deficiency. Again, we do mixing studies with normal serum and adsorbed plasma. If it gets corrected with normal serum and not corrected with adsorbed plasma, it becomes factor 10 deficiency. If it is not corrected with normal serum but corrected with adsorbed plasma, it becomes factor 5 deficiency. But if it is not corrected with both normal serum and adsorbed plasma, we do an additional test called thrombin time. What is this thrombin time? We add thrombin to test plasma and look for clot formation and the time that it takes to clot formation. Invariably, thrombin time is prolonged when there is either hypofibrinogenemia, dysfibrinogenemia, or there are increased FTPs that are there. So if thrombin time is normal, we will think of a prothrombin deficiency, but if thrombin time is prolonged, we think of hypofibrinogenemia. So coming to the next important test after PT-APTT, which is a bleeding time. A lot of people don't do this test today because it is a very time-consuming test and requires good training. But done in a proper hands, it can give a vast amount of information. So I will just briefly tell you about this. We use the template method of bleeding time, where we use a very fixed template of fixed dimensions, depth 1 millimeter, length 8 millimeter. So we have the patient sit on a stool and have a BP cuff at about 45 millimeter mercury. And then we make a nick on the volar surface of the arm and keep checking every 30 seconds for the blood to stop using a filter paper. This is what the device looks like. This is the lancet, this is the dye, and this is the template. The sensitivity of a platelet function defect pickup using this method is about 55 to 60%. This is how it is performed on the volar surface. You get the nicks and you have the stopwatch started to measure the time. Alternatively, a new instrument which had come was a platelet function analyzer. We have PFA, 100 and PFA 200, both of which are good analyzers and which are good for screening tests for any platelet defects. So these are sensitive to aspirin, and they are also used for, therefore, assessment of GP2B3A blockade or for screening for 1 milligram. These are less invasive than bleeding time, but the limitations are these are affected by low hematocrit and low platelet counts. So if you have a patient who has a prolonged bleeding time and a normal platelet count, you will think in terms of a platelet function defect. So one will go in for more specific tests for identifying the underlying defect. And what we do is we look at platelet aggregometry. The reagents that we have are risdiplam, which is an antibiotic, which is used to measure the agglutination, or aggregation using ADP, adrenaline, and collagen, which are the reagents that we use for picking up platelet aggregation, and follow this up with electron microscopy. This is what a platelet aggregometer looks like. And here the principle is that light transmission is inversely proportional to platelet aggregation. Means as you have platelet rich plasma, there will be very less of light transmission. When you add an agonist, they will aggregate, so light transmission will increase. So therefore we set the zero at 10 using a PRP, which has virtually negligible light transmission. And we set it at 100. You add 80 point using a platelet poor plasma where there is almost 100% light transfer. And then we put this is where we put all these cuvettes, and then we look at the reading that we get on the graph paper here. Today we have a better high-end platelet aggregometer where we have a screen which shows the aggregation of the various reagents. So what are the kind of charts that we can get on aggregation? So this is typically seen in Glanzmann's thrombocythemia, where you have absent aggregation using ADP of adrenaline, arachidonic acid, and collagen. And it gives you a normal aggregation with risdiplam, which, as I said, is not true aggregation, but agglutination or adhesion. However, in von Willebrand's disease, we know that risdiplam aggregation is absent. Why? Because there is absence of von Willebrand factor, which is required for adhesion. And therefore, you get an absent aggregation. I would like you to remember that you have another platelet function disorder called a Bernard-Soulier syndrome, where also you will get absent aggregation with risdiplam. But in Bernard-Soulier syndrome, there is a defect in the receptor glycoprotein 1B. And therefore, when you add normal plasma to this, it will not correct. Unlike von Willebrand disease, where the receptor glycoprotein 1B is intact. And therefore, when you add normal control plasma to patient plasma and repeat aggregation, you will get a good aggregation. This is hallmark of von Willebrand's disease. Unlike what you get in the other Bernard-Soulier syndrome, which I told you, here again, what you will get, there is an absent aggregation with risdiplam, but when you add control plasma to this patient plasma, it does not correct. So this is how you can very simply pick up the difference between the two diseases, von Willebrand's disease and Bernard-Soulier disease. And then one can follow up this using an activity assay of von Willebrand's, that is a risdiplam cofactor assay, where you run it in dilutions and then prepare a graph and read off the value of the VWF activity. You can also do von Willebrand antigen, which is done by ELISA and has a normal values between 77 to 97%. Now, important it is to know that risdiplam-induced platelet aggregation that we talked about is generally done at 1 milligram per ml concentration. There is also a variant of von Willebrand's disease where you get hyperaggregation with low-dose risdiplam. So remember, it is not absent here, it is hyperaggregation with low-dose risdiplam. So therefore, for a von Willebrand disease, you would ideally want to do an antigen, a risdiplam-induced platelet aggregation, risdiplam cofactor assay, and multimeric analysis, though people talk about it, is mainly a research tool. You can also do collagen binding assays. That's how we do ELISA. You have to have an ELISA reader, and then you read it on that. Now, coming to the acquired coagulation or bleeding disorders that are there. If we look at the same kind of picture of isolated prolonged APTT and a normal PT, then it could be several things. It could be patient has received heparin, or the patient has inhibitors, which may be either lupus anticoagulants or factor inhibitors. If we think of heparin therapy, we look at the APTT ratio with heparin-sensitive APTT reagent. And if we find it is up to 2, 2.5, it is adequate. Lupus anticoagulant, if we suspect, we resort to dilute Russell Viper venom time or kaolin clotting time. And if it is factor inhibitor, as I told you, we resort to mixing studies with normal plasma. So I already talked a little bit on this. We'll just go a little bit in depth. Screening for inhibitors. We look at immediately acting inhibitor and time-dependent inhibitor. So these are the tests that I already told you. We can also do heparin assays to monitor dose of heparin. And we can do phospholipid neutralization assays to pick up lupus. And if we suspect inhibitors on screening, we will do Bethesda assays. So these are all the specific tests that we resort to after we have done screening for various inhibitors. So this is the typical kind of picture that you get in mixing tests in lupus anticoagulant. In the normal plasma to patient plasma, there is absence of correction of APTT, which you can then confirm using platelet neutralization test. So this is how you actually put up the inhibitor screen for APTT. You take normal plasma, test plasma, 1:1 mixed, and then you take incubated plasma. And depending on the results that you get, if you get either you can get factor deficiency when it shows correction on addition of 1:1. If there is absence of correction, it is an immediate inhibitor. But when you've incubated and you've found that there is a correction, non-incubated, there is a correction, but in incubated, there is no correction. It is time-dependent inhibitor, as you typically get in factor 8 deficiency inhibitors. Once you pick up a screening for inhibitor positive, you can do quantitative analysis and do a Bethesda assay. So here we take serial dilutions of test plasma. We do residual factor 8 assay in each of these, and we plot a graph. That's how we typically do it, 50-50 mix. Incubate for 2 hours and do several factor 8 assays. So the dilution of the test plasma that gives a residual factor 8, which is nearest to 50%, is chosen for calculating the strength of inhibitor. And therefore, any residual factor less than 25 or 75% should not be used. So the inhibitor titer is derived, therefore, from the graph, and you multiply it by the dilution to give the final titer, which is there. So on the y-axis is the log scale, and on x-axis is linear, and residual factor 8 is plotted on the y-axis and the Bethesda titer on the linear x-axis. This is how we do it, standard curve of Bethesda assay. This is a log scale, this is a linear scale, and we look at the value of Bethesda assay. Shortcomings are there, presence of antiphospholipid antibodies are there, and if they coexist, there can be a problem. Then the content of factor 8 normal pool plasma may not be enough, and therefore you are not able to pick up inhibitor isotypes in this. So some modifications which have been suggested are that you can inactivate factor 8, which increases with pH and reduced protein concentration. So what are the causes of false positive Bethesda assay? This is the commonest cause of false positive Bethesda assay. So therefore we have Nijmegen modification or a Malmö assay, which are all advantages over the classical Bethesda assay. New Oxford method has an incubation time of 4 hours instead of 2 hours. A lot of people actually follow either of these two assays that are there. We move on to the acquired defects, and again we use the same mixing agents. And you have this position where the PT and APTT both are prolonged. So we consider acquired bleeders like DIC, fibrinolysis, liver disease, or vitamin K deficiency. We do a thrombin time. If it is normal, it is a liver disease or vitamin K disease deficiency. So we look at the LFT. It is abnormal, then it is liver disease. But if it is normal, we can give a shot of vitamin K and test it to be vitamin K deficiency. On the other hand, if thrombin time is abnormal in acquired conditions, you will think of either a DIC or a primary fibrinogenolysis. Look at the platelet count. If it is normal, it could be amount is reduced. It is a QTIC. And we confirm this using either a D-dimer or an FTP. If it is normal or we are thinking of fibrinolysis, we can do a euglobulin clot lysis time. D-dimer. Just a word about D-dimer. It is a very commonly used test, and especially now with COVID, everyone is talking about D-dimer. So I think one should know a little bit about this. So this is a unique marker of fibrin degradation. Its levels reflect cross-linked fibrin, unlike FDP, which actually measures the fibrinogen, fibrin, everything. So there are several, there are several D-dimer assays that you can use, semi-quantitative or quantitative. Today, most of us use quantitative assays. So what is the role of D-dimer? So let me just tell you that D-dimer is a very non-specific test and can be elevated in a number of conditions. So the ISTH, or the International Society for Thrombosis and Hemostasis, has devised a scoring system for DIC in which D-dimer is one of the important parameters, along with a prothrombin time, a platelet count, and a fibrinogen. So if you have a moderate increase of D-dimer, it gets a score of 2. You get a strong increase in D-dimer, you get a score of 3. And these are the various scoring systems for PT prolongation, platelet count, and fibrinogen. And you eventually calculate the score in a patient. A score greater or equal to 5 is suggestive of overt DIC. If the score is less than 5, it is a non-overt DIC, or maybe even not a DIC. So we can also have some point of care tests which can quantitate D-dimer. This is one of the VDAS that we had validated and gives a quick result. Then people, even though I feel that D-dimer is a very specific test for fibrin degradation, still people use FDP or fibrinogen degradation products. This can be done using a latex agglutination method. And again, you can interpret it, either it is no agglutination or there is an agglutination. And based on it, you can say whether the level is less than 5 microgram per ml or is it more than that. Coming to an acquired condition of isolated PT prolongation and APTT normal, you will think in terms of either acquired condition of mild liver disease, and then you can check with LFT or a warfarin effect may be there. We know warfarin is given as an oral anticoagulant and it causes prolongation of PT. But then there is a term called INR, which we all need to know about. So this INR actually normalizes the PT values from different labs and takes into account the different thromboplastins that are being used. So we do this as prothrombin time of the patient divided by mean normal prothrombin time, which is calculated by measuring the prothrombin times of 20 people and take the geometric mean in the denominator. Raise it to the power of international sensitivity index, which is given for each thromboplastin, and then you get a INR. You can also use a point of care, which we have available for Coagucheck, which is for measurement of INR. A word about thromboelastogram, and this is a point of care test for hemostasis. And this is specifically used for conditions where there could be both. There could be a prothrombotic and pro-bleeding disorder. Gives a sum up of all these. This is what a typical thromboelastogram looks like. And if you look at the various parameters, we have a reaction time, which is actually your clotting test. We have a K time, which measures slow clotting. And if it is reduced, suggests a hypercoagulable state. Similarly, reaction time, if it is increased, it suggests bleeding. If it is reduced, it suggests hypercoagulability. Then we look at the maximal amplitude in a stable clot. If R and K are normal, then a reduced maximal amplitude suggests a platelet dysfunction. So these are the various patterns that we can get on a thromboelastogram. And you have hemophilia, you have a prolonged R time, a reduced time here. And you have given platelet blockers, you have a normal time here, but the amplitude is less. But when you have fibrinolysis, you get prolonged fibrinolysis coming here. In hypercoagulable state, you have shortened R time and you can have increased amplitude. In DIC, it depends what stage you are seeing. In stage 1, you may have hypercoagulability, but in stage 2, you may just have bleeding because of, as you can see, prolonged R time and bleeding narrow maximal amplitude. What are the clinical applications for this? We don't usually do it for routines. We do it in point of care in operation theaters, specifically cardiac surgery, interventional cardiology and radiology in critical care settings, and in various satellite sites like dialysis, ECMO, emergency rooms, and anticoagulation. So these cannot really replace PT-APTT. So we have to make sure that we are able to do those tests, and they can certainly add value as a point of care test in emergency settings. And last but not the least, it is very important to ensure that there is a good quality assurance. We have to take care of internal quality assurance and external quality assurance. We have to take care that we get regular controls, and the controls should include normal and abnormal controls once in a fortnight. You can take a low control or to keep regular surveillance of the lactate report to ensure corrective. Thank you all for a very patient hearing.